as that water comes in so that you can help maintain the safety of the water and the water infrastructure within your home as this restoration moves through. At this point, I'll turn it over to Avril Pender, but I just got a message right as I was walking up to this podium that the laundry facility at the community comfort station in AC Reynolds has arrived and is operating. So now that community care station will be able to offer laundry services as well at Reynolds, at AC Reynolds High School. County Manager Pender.
Thanks, Lillian. Good morning. As of this morning, there are 18,000 Duke Power customers.
Okay. Stop. Can I say Southwest? Okay. We are having a number of technical difficulties this morning. But we will start all over again. And it gives me another opportunity to celebrate this crew. So, good morning. Today is Saturday, October 12th, and this is the community briefing. And as you can tell, we've been at it for a while. We want to start off today's community briefing with some really, really good news. I've shared previously, I live in the Swannanoa Black Mountain area, right kind of in the line there. And last night, as I drove home from work, I ran into this awesome crew from the City of Asheville's Water Department. Like Assistant City Manager Ben Woody shared yesterday, they were activating the 36-inch bypass, moving water from the North Fork Reservoir. My neighbors and I can confirm that water is beginning to flow. And for the first time in more than 2 weeks, folks in Swannanoa had water flowing through their pipes. I high-fived this crew big time, offered them all the snacks that I could find in my house. But can we just take a moment here and join me at home? Join me if you're in the car listening to this on the radio right now. But let's have a collective celebration for the work that these six individuals and all of the water crews are doing around the clock, 24/7. To get this water flowing back into our community. Their crews are going to keep working from there, but this is one giant step forward in water restoration throughout the county. Like Black Mountain Fire Chief Coffey said yesterday, there are breaks in these lines. There are fire hydrants that are missing throughout the system. So it will be not a fast process for us to get to full restoration, but the process is underway. A few reminders as you get water, and I hope my husband figured out that he can listen to this on the radio, so I hope he's listening now so he can get tips at our house. This water contains sediment, but it is highly chlorinated to provide as much disinfection as possible. A boil water notice is in effect, so boil that water vigorously for at least 1 minute. You can also just use bottled water for drinking, cooking, or brushing your teeth. Turn off those ice makers. For us at my house, we have an old fridge. It's just a little thing that you flip up and down. But check your fridge if you have an ice maker and turn those off so you don't have sediment going through that. Close the valve on your hot water heater. Close the valve on your hot water heater to prevent sediment from accumulating. Once the water is restored, you can open that back up and pour that discolored water through the drain in your bathtub. Or if you're like me, use it to water your plants. I will turn this over to County Manager Avril Pender now. I got word just as I was stepping up here that the laundry facility at AC Reynolds is there and is working, and so that community care station at AC Reynolds High School has that laundry facility as well as of 11:15. So County Manager Pender.
Good morning. As of this morning, there are 18,000 Duke Power customers without power. We will be joined by representatives from Duke again at our Tuesday community briefing. The Buncombe County Board of Commissioners' regularly scheduled October 15th meeting will be held fully remote. The meeting can be watched live on the county Facebook page at www.facebook.com/buncombegov. As we continue to provide food and water distribution, we had made one change. The Sandhill Elementary distribution site is being relocated to Buncombe County Sports Park, which is in the same driveway as the Sandhill location at 58 APAC Drive in Asheville. Other water distribution sites are William Estes Elementary School, North Rainier Ridge Intermediate School, Fairview Elementary School, Black Mountain Ingalls, Lester Elementary School, Asheville Middle School, Linwell Crump Shiloh Community Center, Pat Square Park, Lucy Heron Elementary School, and Oakley Elementary School. Our community shelters, we have space available at all of our shelters. The shelters are AB Tech, Conference Center, 16 Ferninghurst Drive, Medical Emergency Shelter, which is also on the AB Tech campus. This is for individuals that are dependent on medical equipment. That shelter is located at 10 Genevieve Circle, the former Gold's Gym on Hendersonville Road. 1815 Hendersonville Road is a family-friendly shelter, and the WNC Ag Center is a pet-friendly shelter at 1301 Frontenbridge Road in Fletcher. For farm businesses with damages that were directly related to Hurricane Helene, you're eligible to apply to the WNC Communities Immediate Disaster Needs Grant Program. Farm businesses, again, that have damages from Helene are eligible. This grant is meant to provide resources directly for farms with urgent needs that impact the ability to get the farm business back in operations as soon as possible. You can go to wnccommunities.org or email grants@wnccommunities.org. That is grants@wnccommunities.org. Today, Novant Health will have a community care cruiser. That's going to be on site at A.C. Reynolds High School at 1 Rocket Drive from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. And they will be available all day, every day. Not all day, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m., but they'll be available every day. They're offering urgent care services, including connections to obstetrics, pediatrics, as well as a mobile pharmacy. These medical resources will be available to all patients at no cost. A community care station where people can shower, and disaster recovery center with FEMA and SBA assistance is also located. And you heard Lillian tell you that the laundry facility is also available at AC Reynolds. The community care center in Swannanoa is open and running today until 7 p.m. Our next community care center will be open in Barnesville tomorrow. Mercy Urgent Care Clinic in East Asheville, located at 1272 Tunnel Road, will reopen tomorrow, Saturday, Sunday, October 13th, from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. That is the Mercy Urgent Care Clinic in East Asheville at 1272 Tunnel Road will open tomorrow, Sunday, October 13th, from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. The other Mercy Urgent Care that have already reopened include the South Asheville, the Weaverville, and the West Asheville sites. Our FEMA partner continues to move throughout the community to support survivors. Today, they be at various locations. One in Black Mountain, and that's at the pod distribution site at 550 NC9 in Black Mountain. The Walmart at 60 Airport Road in Arden, Pat Square Park at 80 Court Square in Asheville, New Bridge Baptist Church, 199 Elkwood Avenue in Asheville, the Riceville Volunteer Fire Department, that's at 2251 Riceville Road, Reams Creek the Beach Community Center at 15 State Highway, 2117 Weaverville. A.C. Reynolds High School at Juan Rocket Drive in Asheville. They'll also be canvassing in the Biltmore area, and that means that they're going door to door and connecting and offering assistance directly with residents. So the Biltmore area canvassing. They'll be at the Swannanoa Library at 101 West Charleston Avenue in Swannanoa. They'll begin canvassing in the Swannanoa area starting at the Swannanoa Library. They'll be canvassing in Fairview, starting at the Food Line at 1350 Charlotte Highway. Canvassing is also starting in Leicester, and they're starting at the Chosen Generation Church, 876 New Leicester Highway. That's in the Leicester community. And in Barnesville, 1675 Barnesville Highway in Barnesville. So that's the FEMA people. Remember, watch out for scammers. FEMA would always have a badge and will never ask you for money. Today, our transfer station at Harmony Creek is open until 1 p.m. This is for bag household trash, and the landfill is open until 3 p.m. The City of Asheville is looking to resume trash and recycling collection on a regular schedule beginning on Monday. With that, I'll turn it over to Dave Connolly, our partners from the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers.
Thank you, ma'am. I just wanted to thank the county, the communications department, Lillian, for inviting us here. And of course, Ms. Pender for letting us participate. I don't know my name. By way of introduction, my name is Dave Connolly. I am the chief of public affairs for the Wilmington District at the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. I know a lot of people may not be familiar with our organization or what we do. So my intent today would be to give you a little bit of an overview, not too detailed, but enough of an overview, tell you what we are and how we operate. And then I want to walk through some of the missions that we've been given here in this area. So first, if some may be not familiar with the national framework, as they call it, we are responsible for emergency response function number 3, which is basically public works. And how it works is the Army Corps of Engineers, are tasked by FEMA. So what happens is the process is, if the county or the cities and the counties have an issue they can't handle, they push it up to the state. The state can't handle it, they push it up to the federal government, which then is FEMA, and then FEMA will turn to us and give us tasks. So I apologize for Colonel Morgan. I work for a guy named Colonel Brad Morgan, who is the district commander out in Wilmington, and he is responsible for this recovery effort out in Western North Carolina. And so the first thing I want to say is, I know there's some people might think, oh, we're just going to leave and go to the next disaster or down to Florida. We're not going anywhere. This is Colonel Morgan's footprint. This is where we're going to be until the work is done. So how that works is FEMA has tasked us so far with, basically, it's really turned into 5 sort of different mission areas. We've got a temporary power mission. We have a debris mission, and we have an infrastructure assessment mission, which is basically centered around water and wastewater. We also have, and they've mentioned a few times, the community care stations. I always mess up that wording, but we are just basically in an advise and assist role for the county. That's the county stations. They've set them up, they're operating them, and we're just there in case they need any advice or assistance in those things. So let me walk through each one of these and just kind of tell you what we've done so far. We've had teams on the ground since at least 15 days now. And the way the Army Corps of Engineers works is, we, under our division, which is headquarters in Atlanta, we have 6 districts, from Wilmington, Charleston, Savannah, Jacksonville, Mobile, and out in Puerto Rico. So we are always postured, you know, before every hurricane season, we get together, we do what's called tabletop exercises to make sure we're prepared. We prepare for at least 2 to possibly 3 simultaneous emergencies at a time. So again, going back to my earlier thought about, we're not going anywhere. We got enough assets and capability in place to stay here in Western North Carolina as long as it takes. For the temporary power mission alone, essentially what it is the first they'll go out and do assessments when asked to do assessments. And so far to date, we've installed, and again, these numbers change pretty fluidly, but we've installed 18 generators across the affected counties, not just here in Buncombe County, but all the affected counties in Western North Carolina. And today, in fact, the team is, so right now they were staged, we call a generator staging base, which was stationed in Charlotte, North Carolina. We ended up just this morning, those teams, we forward deployed a GSB to get a little bit closer to the impacted area. So they just took some folks out to Hendersonville, North Carolina to pre-position there. There's also a debris mission. Now, right now, the debris, the initial mission for us was to kind of scope out what is the problem? How much debris are we talking about? And that started as back as far as 30 September. And so after those assessments, it was estimated that there's 10 million cubic yards of debris, and it's various forms of debris. So we're working closely now with the state and the counties to figure out what is needed. So again, going back to that process, we're at the point now where we need to know from all the affected counties, what can you do on your own? What can you not do on your own? And that information will get pushed up to the state, will be prioritized. And again, we're focused on critical, you know, public works, you know, it's health and safety, it's law enforcement, it's hospitals, it's clinics, whatever the priority is by dictated by the communities that will get filtered up. That's where we'll actually start seeing what it is that FEMA will task us to do. And then moving on to infrastructure, again, a lot of that was focused on water and wastewater. And again, the initial assessments were kind of those preliminary, you know, we had to get on the ground and work with, no kidding, the plant operators. How does this plant operate? How does the system work? Is it privatized? So all that preliminary stuff has been going on for the last 15 days or so. And now we're finally getting into the, you know, the detailed assessments. And with these water and wastewater plants, there's a very small subject matter expertise within Wilmington. So we're having to grab experts from all over the enterprise, we call it, across all of the country and USACE, and get into detailed assessments. So to date, we've done a total of 287 those preliminary assessments, just four in the last 24 hours. And now we've done at least one of those detailed assessments. Again, as I talked about that water pushing through the pipes, now you're chasing those leaks, finding out where the issues are. So, you know, we're just getting into more finer detail on those. You know, altogether, we've got probably about 250 people to include green suit, Army Corps of Engineer personnel, civilians like myself, and contractors on the ground now. And we're postured to be here for the duration. There's also another mission of temporary water. We got a team of experts from New Orleans District who will be looking at what can we do to lessen that distance. You know, you're trucking in water now. Is there a better way? Can we get our systems in place to kind of use that reverse osmosis system? Where are those locations at? So they're trying to assess that, and how can we help with that? How can we help purify water and cut down that time of getting fresh water to people? And then subject to any questions, I think that's about all I have. Thank you.
And we'll have questions for Dave at the end. Finally, we're gonna hear from Allie Kasparian. Allie is Swannanoa resident. She's also the founder and executive director of Bounty and Soul. And she's going to share a little bit about how their operation is helping to support community members during this time.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for inviting us into the space to share what Bounty and Soul is doing. I was mentioning to folks that this is the first time I've had makeup on in 14 or 15 days. So that's something to celebrate. So Bounty and Soul is a food and nutrition security organization based in the Swannanoa Valley that works at the intersection of food, farms, and health. I am proud to say that the day after the storm, we were boots on the ground supporting relief efforts in Black Mountain and Swannanoa. We are currently providing food, hot meals, supplies, and fresh food to around anywhere between 10 and 18 sites. These sites can be neighborhoods, churches, housing units, individual houses. We also have community connectors out there that are connecting with community members to ask, what do you need? What do you want? And those needs and wants change every day. We are hearing, you know, in the last probably 48 hours that as people are getting power back, that they want to cook. So true to our mission of fresh food, we are going to be mobilizing our fresh food truck that will be going out to areas next week in the Swannanoa, Black Mountain, and Fairview area. So again, it's, you know, Swannanoa has been a devastated area. Being a resident there, you know, witnessing the devastation, but also seeing the tenacity and care that neighbors have for one another is just been overwhelming. The other thing I want to mention is that in Swannanoa, we have mobilized our Latinx community hub. It is a safe and trusted place where the Latinx community can come and receive culturally relevant hot meals, food, supplies, and very vital information that may not be accessible. For example, we had the Mexican consulate there this past week to talk to folks about if they had lost any of their documents, helping them to retrieve those type of items. The other thing, and also that is a mobile effort. So we have a team that goes out door to door, neighborhood to neighborhood, to ensure that the Latinx community is seen, supported. And like I have said from the beginning, this is a marathon and not a sprint. And we are committed for the long haul. This organization has always been one that is community invested, community supported. And we know that there are communities that are suffering, that need support, and are ready to, you know, build back. So we are here for the long haul, and appreciate all the support and resources that we have received from all over North Carolina and out of state. So we're very grateful. The last thing I want to mention, there has been word that Swannanoa has been chaotic or lacking leadership, or that there hasn't been a coordinated effort. And I will tell you that that is not true, that there is a collaboration of community leaders, businesses, other nonprofits, churches, community members that meet every day. We are called the Swannanoa Grassroots Alliance, and it is a coordinated, there are coordinated efforts, collaborations that are happening to help communities stabilize and know that leadership is working alongside them to build back. So thank you. Thank you for your support. We are always in the need of donations. The other thing I want to mention, that our farms have been impacted, and we are committed to supporting our local food system and making our farmers whole. So donations are being accepted now to pay farmers so that we can distribute fresh produce through our farmers market truck in the coming weeks and months and years. So we welcome donations to support our farmers. We are accepting donations of blankets and any cold weather materials for this next week, impending cold weather. So any of those donations are welcome. You can go to our website, bountyandsoul.org, to see how you can support, get involved, and be part of building Swannanoa, Western North Carolina back. Thank you.
Thank you, Allie. At this time, we will open it up to questions from our media who are on a separate Zoom call in the background of this stream. Do we have any questions in the comments?
Hi, Lillian. It's Laura at BPR. My question's about...
I was going to ask if you had a question, Laura.
Hi. My question is, can you hear me?
We can.
Great. It's about cell service, we talked yesterday about reaching out to Verizon, AT&T, T-Mobile. Our understanding is that the delays that were caused at the FEMA site yesterday at AC Reynolds were due to losing that connectivity. Do we have any update on when people can expect to get cell service back?
So we brought in a Starlink at that location to bolster that service there. So that's fully operational. I will say anecdotally, I am one of those people who experienced power coverage reduction when I would basically leave the city limits. And now I have AT&T. Now I have service coverage at my home. We are working to get folks in here to help answer those questions for you, but we just don't have them here tonight. But we've got your request, and we'll see if we can have some participation at the briefing, or that may be something that as the Army Corps of Engineers continues their work, they'll be able to brief you directly on.
And one other question about the community care centers. You said there's one opening up in Barnardsville tomorrow. And is that, what, do we have time for that? What time that open?
We will announce that when it's open. You know, one of the things, we don't have all of these resources to open these community care centers at our, just in our backyard, right? So some of these vehicles are coming from California. Some of them are coming from Texas. Some are being built specifically to our specifications of what we need. And so all of that is happening. So we can't say like a firm, it will be this time on this day, because we're truly working as quickly as we can to get these from a number of different sources that are not local and are not readily available.
And just one more follow-up on that. Do we anticipate having more of these opening progressively, incrementally in different parts of the county?
100% absolutely and unequivocally, yes. I did fail to mention, Ben is here from the city, and we do have city representatives. So if there are questions specific to the city of Asheville, they are here to help answer those questions. Clay Chandler, the water PIO, is here too. So they are in the background, but they are here. Any questions in the chat? Wait just a few more seconds to see if anyone has any follow-up questions.
If no one else has one, I do have one more about Black Mountain Water.
Go for it.
We understand that they've reconnected with City Water and have asked Ben and Clay this, but wondering if you know this just from knowing the whole county. Is that they're telling people don't use that water for anything other than flushing?
Correct.
And I'm wondering why the distinction there when people can use it for other things in the rest of the area.
Clay Chandler is going to come help you out with that. But yes, if you are in that town of Black Mountain, that is true.
Good morning, Laura. So City of Asheville, our only role in the Blackwater Mountain system is to get water to their primary pump station. Beyond that, they own and operate their own distribution system, which is completely separate from ours. So they would be better equipped to answer the question why they've implemented the regulations they have.
And Clay, while we have you, could you just reiterate, we've had a lot of questions, as I said, about the boiling water situation. Can you just recap that?
Sure. So the water that started coming out of North Fork yesterday, it's going to have elevated levels of sediment. And so those customers who have water now and will get water in the future will be under a boil water notice. What that means is for any kind of consumption, drinking, cooking, brushing teeth, the EPA, which developed all of this language, by the way, the EPA is recommending that if it's available, you need to use bottled water for things like that, like consumption. But if it is not, if you boil the water vigorously for a minimum of 1 minute, it will be safe to drink. It won't be pretty. It's going to be cloudy. It's going to have a little bit of a chlorine odor. But if you boil it, you can use it for consumption. And it's safe for straight out of the tap for washing hands, doing laundry, washing dishes, showering, just don't swallow any water while you're in the shower. Small children need to be monitored to make sure they don't swallow any water in the bath or anything like that. And infants, probably a good idea to give them a sponge bath.
Good.
All right. With that, we will conclude our Saturday community briefing. Thank you. We will see you again tomorrow morning at 11 a.m. right here.